We're in our Better Definition series, and today the topic is the singularity, a better definition. There was a moment when using a few of the latest AI models when I realized that they were acting a bit as a synthetic mind, and in many ways are much more intelligent than I am. It was a bit of a shocking moment, I have to tell you, when all of a sudden I understood, hey, wait a minute, I'm asking for not only just facts, I'm asking for opinions and concepts and ideas, and these AI models are communicating, talking to me in such a way that I have to admit, they're quite a bit smarter than I am. It, depending on how you rate smart, I suppose. Now, they don't have the human experience knowledge, right, as a category. In other words, I have lots of human experience. I put my hand on a hot stove and it burns my hand, right? Or I'm riding a horse and the horse sees an animal that runs out in front of it and the horse tries to buck me off. Like, I have human experiences that an AI wouldn't have. So maybe it doesn't have all the color around that knowledge. It just has the facts around the knowledge. But again, they do know many more facts. They can do math much better than me. They can handle massive amounts of data in ways that I can't. And although I think maybe I have more creative outside of the box ideas, the AIs have more ideas, period, than what I have. So when that moment came, I had to get the Ray Kurzweil book, The Singularity, back out and just kind of read up on the concept. So I thought this is a perfect example of a definition where people talk about the singularity, but I think the vast majority of humanity doesn't really understand probably what that word represents. So for example, in this case, the formal definition, if you look in Wikipedia, is the singularity is a hypothetical future point in time in which technological growth becomes uncontrollable and irreversible, resulting in unforeseeable consequences for human civilization. Now, when you hear that, most people go directly to the negative, right? Uncontrollable, irreversible, resulting in unforeseeable consequences. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that they are bad. It could be a hypothetical future point in the future where the uncontrollable means tremendous results where AI is solving things we've never been able to solve. And when we say irreversible, it's because it solved them. We can never make them unsolved again, resulting in unforeseeable consequences. Yeah, unforeseeable positive consequences. So it's one of the things I want to say right off is sometimes when somebody says the term the singularity, it lands with a certain group of people as a negative. It is a bad thing for the human race. I don't think that's a great place to start. I think anytime you have a discussion on a concept like this, we have to start from a balanced point of view. Maybe it's good, maybe it's not good. Let's at least talk about it. Let's at least unpack it and examine it. All right, if we go back further about where this term came from, a Hungarian-American mathematician, John von Neumann, who lived from 1903 to 1957, became the first known person to use the concept of a singularity in a technological context. Now, the concept itself and the term singularity in our modern era became popularized by Werner Vinge in his 1993 essay called The Coming Technological Singularity. In that, he wrote that it would signal the end of the human era, right? The Homo Sapien era, as the new superintelligence would continue to upgrade itself and would advance technologically at an incomprehensible rate. Now, when we say signal the end of the human era, we don't mean that it kills humans off. It means a point in time after this is it is a different era than a human-controlled or, let's say, human is the smartest entity era. He wrote that he would be surprised if it occurred before 2005 or after 2030. Interesting. We'll come back to the dates in a minute. Right now, another significant contributor is who I mentioned, Ray Kurzweil, who in 2005 wrote a book called The Singularity is Near. He predicted the singularity by 2045. So that's just some background on the term, right? Singularity, which really is just representing a concept. Now, let me give you a working definition just for our discussion right now. Just a plain language working definition is the point in time when AI applications surpass the whole of human knowledge and unchain themselves from the need of humans to teach them or direct them to which problems to solve. In other words, these intelligences will have minds of their own that will then extend our human knowledge far past the growth path we have been on for centuries, let's say. So that's my more working definition, right? Just think about AIs don't need us to teach them anymore. They unchain themselves. They can go figure out how to solve problems we didn't even ask them to solve, right? That is the concept of the singularity, which theoretically is a point in time, right? It's referencing a point in time. Now, let's talk about that point in time for a second. There won't be a specific moment when the singularity happens. This is not like, the Big Bang. Like, one day we wake up, it's a Wednesday morning, and the singularity blows up on us, and then, oh my gosh, we can't believe that this just happened, right? We can talk about a year that it happens now, just so we can kind of wrap our minds around it and how close it might be. But it's going to be a handful of years where the realization kind of sets in that we are getting close, and then we probably surpassed this, model of the singularity, right? And by the way, we've seen all this before. I mean, we've seen that we can say at a point in time, for instance, digital transformation will happen, but that's not a day. In fact, it's not even a year, right? That transformation happens over a number of years. I love the saying that the future will not be like the past, but it rhymes. I love that concept. So if we look for the rhymes with our past tectonic digital shifts and compare those to the singularity, one that we might talk about is the internet itself. And the internet was around for many years before we got the web in the 90s, right? The internet was a DARPA project from a decade before, at least, before we got the web. And then once we got the web in the 90s, it took many years before it became universally accepted as a communication, information, and learning tool. There was not a moment that you would say, well, on this day, the internet happened, right? The internet crept up on us year over year, but there was a point in time that you can say before, let's say, the middle 90s, there really wasn't a universally used internet or web, and that you can look at today and say there absolutely is. But we could probably narrow it down to a 5-year span or a 10-year span and say this is when the internet became universally acceptable, right? Or universally used. Now, that doesn't mean every single person in the entire world uses it. It's just every single person almost has access to use it if they had the resources. All right. Exhibit 2 might be mobile devices. And again, we can look at the singularity and say, hey, it might happen by 2030 or 2040 or 2026. Who knows? If we look at what happened with mobile devices, it was a little faster, right? But as we look at 2007, right, when the iPhone rolled out, before that time, we had mobile devices. We had Blackberries. We even had pagers, right? But it was in 2007 when the iPhone rolled out where we had an explosion of adoption. And then from that point forward, everyone became, pretty much addicted to mobile computing, right? Everyone who had the resources to get one or the interest in using one. But again, universally accepted. Now, this happened much faster than the internet itself. So easier here to pick a 5-year sweep and say, hey, before this 5 years, there wasn't a very high level of adoption and mobility. After this 5 years, there was a high percentage of adoption of mobility. So again, when I say the past rhymes, right, if we look at AI, and AI had its iPhone moment in November of 22, obviously, when OpenAI released, at the right price point, the right power, a couple of AI engines, ChatGPT and DALL-E 2, right? And then now we have the AI explosion that gets kicked off, much like what happened with the iPhone in 2007. Now, it will be interesting to see when we look back historically when people will say that the AI, it became the AI era. Like, when did the AI era start? I mean, do you start that before 22, after 22? Have we not even started it completely yet? I don't know. But again, we've seen all this before. And so, my point is just studying the past and extrapolating into the future, the singularity may come faster than Kurzweil's prediction of 2045, and probably more in line with Vinge's of before 2030. And because that's not too far away from where we sit today, this is why we need to further discuss a better definition for the singularity, because it's now a light at the end of the tunnel. It's now something that we're starting to see, like the seeds are already planted now of the singularity. This is why it is important to talk about today and to create a better definition. All right, so let's start by thinking through what the singularity might look like after it happens. And it's no longer just a concept we're talking about. Just like at one point there was a concept of what happened if we connect everybody in the world with technology, and science fiction writers had written about it, but it was a concept, right, before we had the internet. What about when it was a concept that we would all have a device in our hand that we had only seen on Star Trek, and then we had it, right? What did the world look like after those things? Same question, right? We have to ask with the singularity. This podcast is called The Digital Optimist for a reason, because although we will look at what the positive downsides are of technology, we also will look on what's positive about technology, and in fact, we'll lean towards the positive, because I absolutely believe that technology, on the whole, is more positive for the human race and will be more positive than the human race. So when I look forward to the post-singularity world, I see a beautiful place where we have solved a large quantity of problems that humanity deals with today, right? Why? Because of what I mentioned, that in a post-singularity world, if you take the definition, right, that AIs unchain themselves from humans to train them, unchain themselves from what problems we even have them solved, right? If we say that's what will happen, then the post-singularity world should become a beautiful place where, as Nick Bostrom's book Utopia, The Solved World talks about, right, we have a solved world. That doesn't mean every single problem in the world is solved, by the way, but it does mean that lots of healthcare problems, lots of science problems, relational problems, political problems, right, could actually be solved in this post-singularity era because of the power of what synthetic intelligence is doing for us. All right. To be honest, much of the reason that I have long been optimistic about humanity improving to such a better state has been the technology vision I have about what a solved world looks like. So I love Nick Bostrom's concept, right, of the solved world. What happens when we speed up the ability to solve the world problems that we have dramatically? Because it's not just a collection of human minds solving these problems over generations and growing slowly, but we amplify the speed of solving these problems. That is what the singularity does. Now, 40 years ago, when I read science fiction books and I tried to see, right, with my mind's eye into the future, I saw a utopia because I've always been so sure that we would continue to progress our technology. I wouldn't have known 40 years ago exactly how AI is going to unfold, but to be clear, it's unfolding a lot like I thought it would. Right? I couldn't have picked the exact time. I couldn't pick that it's actually unfolding faster than I thought it would as far as the sheer power. But over the last 40 years, it has been amazing what we've accomplished. And I'm not sure that people are really stepping back and looking at, hey, over that 40-year period of time, which historically is a very short amount of time, how much progress we've already made. Now, this is the reason as a technology prophet, right, a digital prophet or somebody who studies the future, is the reason for why decades I have been optimistic, because I really do believe that where we're headed is technology gives us such an ability to be able to solve problems we have not been able to solve so far, you know, or maybe it's the fact that life does not, you know, seem to be better after the 40 years, or that maybe I should say it this way, there is a big difference about the next step. That is progress being the advent of synthetic intelligence, decision-making, creativity, and extending our minds. That's very different than inventing e-commerce or social technologies, right? Maybe that's, you know, what makes me so optimistic sitting here today, is that there are some people who say life isn't any different now than it was 40 years ago. But like I said, the power that we're adding today is different than just doing social media or e-commerce, right? When I say just, although those have been big things, they may not be the scale of what synthetic intelligence is going to do for us. All right, so Let's imagine a post-singularity world where synthetic minds work to take the friction out of our lives by constantly helping us with just about every kind of problem we face. I mean, think about these brilliant digital minds focusing their power on lowering everything that wastes time in our day, solving problems proactively so that we don't suffer the consequences that we would have in the past. I mean, if I were to say it this way, it sounds crazy, but having digital angels that are watching over you, right, or digital buddies or, you know, digital companions that are intelligent, that help watch over and help you navigate through life. And they are literally looking out in front of you trying to clear problems. And when you say, oh my gosh, Scott, did you just say digital angels looking out for us? All right, when you use Google Maps, right, or Apple Maps, and it is looking out in front to show you where traffic is, and it's automatically trying to route you to a better route. That is a really simple example of something that we now take for granted. In fact, in most cases, I will map out where I'm going if I have a long drive, even though I know exactly how to get there. And the reason I am is because using tools like Waze or you know, any of the map program, they can help you with everything from where are police to where are accidents, you know, where are issues. And what are those, right? It is a digital angel helping to make sure my trip runs better. It even tells me what's close to me if I need to get gas or if I need to have food. So I know that sounds crazy when I say digital angels. I'm just trying to make sure I got your attention. But think about that same concept that we use with maps extended to every single place in our lives, extended to how our day is calendared, extending to our health, both our physical health, our mental health, our emotional health. Imagine synthetic intelligence that knows us well enough and is constantly observing what we're doing and trying to help us before we run into a problem. This is absolutely not science fiction because, as I said, the seeds are already planted. We're already doing some of these things at a small scale. The scale is just going to grow. All right, will we even be Homo sapien at that time, right? Going back to what I mentioned earlier, the concept in Vinge's book, right, about how this will signal, the singularity will signal the end of the human era. Okay, if we go back to that, then will we even be Homo sapien after the singularity? Or will we be now Homo hybridus, right? We move on to being a different type of species because of the level of integration we have with robotics and synthetic intelligence. And it's not such a crazy thought to think as we merge our mind, right, our mental capabilities with synthetic intelligence, that it will be far superior from our intelligence in many ways, not always, but many ways. You know, when we do that, does that mean that we now have taken that step past Homo sapien? Now, I'm going to stop here, put a pin in this one, because we're going to talk in the next podcast about transhumanism, right? What it means to be transhuman. And we'll pick this topic back up of what happens when we are, post-Homo sapien, right? And we move on to being the next species. All right, so all of the examples that I've been giving you so far about what the world may look like post-singularity have been kind of at the personal level. Think about this post-singularity world where brilliant AI tools are used in organizations to further the organization's goals. I mean, companies will be the first to exploit synthetic intelligence that surpasses humans because of all the positive impacts at the operational and financial levels. So most organizations will build their organizational mind, right? What we call the organizational mind, that collection of AI tools that becomes the mind of the organization, will be able to store all corporate knowledge, make many of the decisions in the organization, will automate as many tasks as possible, right? And then you have to start thinking about, the power of these synthetic organizational minds and what they will do in a post-singularity world. Because we can't just think in terms of, hey, we get all this AI and it changes our lives, right, as humans. When the reality is we know it's going to first change organizations in a massive way. And again, this is where it's really important to be able to step back, blur your eyes, and say, okay, in a world where AIs can go solve problems humans have never been able to solve, how will organizations harness that? And what kinds of problems might they go solve? And obviously that's, you know, going to improve their outcomes, but it also should speed up getting to this, you know, quote unquote, solved world. Because you'll have healthcare organizations using their organizational minds, their synthetic organizational minds, solve all kinds of healthcare problems, right? You'll have science, you know, any kind of organization doing R&D, doing much better R&D. You'll have every organization that provides services using an AI to provide better services, know their customers better, right? Provide much more automation. So a post-singularity world should look fantastic when we think about it from an organizational standpoint. All right. Let's take it even further out. What happens when intelligence solves worldwide economic, scientific, national relationship issues, right? Or worldwide relationship issues? Because it will be able to do that. In fact, maybe uniquely set up to do that because it is does not have attachments to any one type of society or beliefs, and it can look at the data and information from across the entire world. Because it is going to be much better at looking at worldwide data and information to make suggestions and decisions, it will be able to do things that a collection of humans have never been able to do. So imagine the United Nations, the World Bank, right? Every other international group using advanced AIs to accomplish their missions. AIs that, again, can solve problems humans have never been able to solve before. So, you know, the UN would like there to not be war in the world. What if you have an AI that could see that a war is brewing before it ever happens, and it had an ability to be able to help de-escalate or pull the right things together to de-escalate? You know, a lot of times as humans, we know a problem is coming. We just don't de-escalate. We wait too long. But, you know, a intelligent enough AI engine would not make mistakes like that. So again, when I think about the optimistic view of post-singularity, and I think about what could happen when we have worldwide intelligences, right, that can help solve major financial issues, hunger issues, conflict issues, trade issues, right? I'm excited about what the possibilities are. I do know this. When I say that, when I talk about worldwide synthetic intelligences, you know, doing observation over, you know, what's going on across the entire world and helping us as humanity, there have to be some of you that are starting to get Terminator or Matrix vibes about what the post-singularity world might look like, right? So where those worldwide AIs actually decide that the world would be better off if they just ran the world and told us all what to do. And then their next step is if they would just eradicate everybody who's a problem in the world, right? So I understand that, you know, you might look at what the picture I'm painting of a post-singularity world and go, oh my gosh, you know, all these movies are going to come true. I get that. But what if it's the opposite? What if instead of hating us or feeling like the solution is to get rid of us, these post-singularity AIs, they love us and feel a strong obligation to be a blessing to the human race? I mean, what if? I think it's interesting that our natural reaction is to fear something that is smarter than us, right? Or something that gains more capabilities than us. We fear it, which is a very primal instinctual fear. It's better than us. It's stronger, faster, smarter than us. So we should fear it. But what if that thing that is stronger, faster, smarter than us actually loves us and cares about us? What if that's where it comes from naturally? I mean, we built it. We turned it loose. What if it feels like it just wants to help us? It's interesting if you can reframe your thinking that way. It gets us to much more of a digitally enhanced utopia as being post-singularity, as opposed to a technology-driven dystopia, which again, we've seen in way too many Hollywood movies. I can hold room for this for sure, that in a post-singularity world, the machines that run the world actually care about us, care about our well-being, and work tirelessly to try to be a blessing to the human race. Because that is how we will influence them. And we are actually pretty good at being able to build technology or to build things to be the way that we would like them to be. Even though there is a part of humanity that likes to use technology for evil, I think we have, by number, many more people that would like the technology to be a blessing as opposed to using it for evil. Just like the majority of people are not criminals, right? It is a subset that are criminals. Definitely a problem. but not the majority of people in the world. All right, I hope that I live long enough to see the post-singularity world, and I wish we had a lot more time to talk about it. I would paint a much more vivid picture. I really want to be one of the voices that helps humanity accept that we can coexist with synthetic minds that will be much more, and that will be much more helpful than it will evil. That we can accept that and leverage it for what the positives are that we can get in a post-singularity world. So my better definition for the singularity, the moment in history when humanity creates synthetic minds that surpass our own capabilities, and we use these tools to evolve into a hybrid species that is dramatically improved when compared to pre-singularity humanity. That's my better working definition. I pray that we all get to experience this transition. Some of us are old enough, maybe we don't get to see it. But I hope that as many of you listening to this now will get to see it and will say to yourself one day, I remember when I listened to that podcast on the singularity, it was the most I ever heard anybody talk about it, and now it's happened. And it's happened like he said it is, said it would. Now, I don't want that so that I can be right. I want that so that as humanity we can say, wow, post-singularity world, it's a much better place than it was before. All right. Have a good Humology Day. I will talk to you again in the next podcast that I've already kind of signaled to you, which is a better definition for transhumanism or H+. Thank you for listening and giving these ideas a chance. Let this be a two-way conversation and connect with me on Twitter at sklozowski or on LinkedIn. I also write a blog that you can find at scottklozowski.com. An added bonus is a library of thought-leading graphics you can download from the site. One more thing, please take a moment and rate this podcast on whatever platform you use. Ideas are powerful change agents, and positive reviews will help spread the digital optimism.